Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here and to share some part of my research on Avicenna psychology. So I would just say that I will focus on, Avicenna wrote a lot on psychology, but I'm focusing on the psychological section of his main Summa, or one of the main Summa, the Book of the Healing or the Cure, so Kitab al-Shifa, or Liber Sufficientia or Sufficientia in Latin. And I will refer to his theory of the soul by using the term psychology, and by means of which I will refer to the science of the soul as it was codified by Aristotle in his De Anima. So what I would like to do today is a kind of tour, I hope not too long, of Avicenna psychology, and in particular to outline the project of Avicenna psychology, what is his aim in his Book of the Soul. And I apologize, but I will read my paper just because I don't want the tour to be too long. So I will say things very briefly and very precisely, I hope. And so the main thing is, within my presentation, will be to match what Avicenna said about his enterprise, what he explicitly says his enterprise is about, and his purpose in doing that. So try to match this with the unsaid, so what is not explicitly said, but we can infer from the process and the method of his inquiry, of his investigation. So the study of the soul, in particular, though not exclusively the human soul, represents the cornerstone of the philosophical system of Avicenna. For it is not only the main topic of psychology, but also the subject of philosophical knowledge. To this topic, as I said, he devoted several sorts of works, let's say monographic treatises, epistles, and parts of his, let's say, summa or encyclopedic works, writings. But he undertakes the most exhaustive inquiry into the soul in his Book of the Soul, Kitab al-Nafs, or Liber de Anima, Seus Extus de Naturalibus, in which he carries out an enterprise similar to the one Aristotle pursued in his De Anima. However, though depending on the Aristotelian source, Avicenna's Nafs contains reflections and concerns that are less Aristotelian, though arising as well from the opaque passages of the Aristotelian writing and their subsequent late ancient exegesis. So I'll just put in the endout under T1 three passages from Aristotle's De Anima in which you can infer probably a different status for the theoretical part of the soul investigated therein, and other passages outside the anima in which Aristotle seems to address the human soul, the rational soul, or the rational part of the soul as a soul with a peculiar status are, for example, the well-known passage in the first book, first chapter of the Partibus Animalium, and also Metaphysics 6.1 or Epsilon 1, where there is this classification of sciences according to their subject, and psychology is addressed as one of the specific natural sciences dealing with a particular soul, namely the one that does not separate from matter. So all of these texts, Aristotelian texts, were in the air, and to these, and to the late ancient and early Arabic reception and exegesis of these texts, Avicenna is somehow reacting or responding. So the main idea is that in Nafs, on the one hand, and in the Aristotelian fashion, Avicenna investigates the soul insofar as it is responsible for the activities observable in bodies, that is the soul qua principle of plant and animal life. Whereas, on the other hand, he attempts to answer the question as whether the soul corrupts or endures, that transcends the boundaries of Aristotle's psychology, but at the same time seems to be conceived as urgent as the investigation of the soul qua principle of plant and animal life. This question concerns the possibility that there might be something more to investigate than the mere phenomenal datum, that is, the soul's being, the principle of activities in bodies. However, this question does not concern every sublunary soul, but rather the human soul, the only instance of soul with respect to which it seems not senseless to investigate what it is in itself, simply because in the case of the human soul, there seems to be an itself aspect which survives after the severance of its relation to the body. Thus, in the Nafs, there are two investigations, at least in my opinion, that run in parallel from the very beginning of the work. The first is the investigation of the soul as a relational entity, always considered in connection with the body, which also leads to the investigation of this entity, essential to the explanation of the body-soul relationship. And second, the investigation of the human soul in itself, which firstly, thou cursorily emerges in Nafs 1.1 with the thought experiment of the flying man, and more explicitly only in Nafs 5.2 and 5.4, where Avicenna demonstrates that the human soul does not subsist as something impressed or imprinted in a corporeal matter, neither as a form nor as a faculty, and answers the question as whether the human soul corrupts together with the corruption of the body or endures. Both investigations aim to ascertain the existence and the essence of the soul in relation to the body and in itself, respectively. So, two investigations with two aspects, respectively. What I would like to investigate today with you are the signs of the emergence of this second investigation in Avicenna's psychology in order to assess if this could fit in the framework of a unitary, spatial, natural science which is ultimately founded in metaphysics. For the in the Shifa, psychology, as well as all the other particular sciences, I would say, has to deal with a specific subject whose existence and quiddity are assumed, and its per se attributes, according to the principles proper to the science in question, and to the sciences subordinate to it, if any. Therefore, every science takes for granted both the existence and the quiddity of its own subject matter. Avicenna's project of refounding and rearranging Aristotelian science into a hierarchical system, with the metaphysics at the top, is retrospectively outlined in Ilayat, namely in the Book of Divine Things or Metaphysics of the Shifa. Unfortunately, I think I will not have the time to go through all these passages, but I've listed a couple in your handout under T2 and T3. So the question now is, does psychology in its entirety conform to this model? Or to be precise, does psychology investigate only an aspect of the soul, while the investigation of the rest of it, notably of its existence and its quiddity, is conducted in another higher discipline, science? At first sight, psychology seems to conform to this model. In the opening line of Nafs 1.1, the main purpose of this treatise is clearly stated, and this is your text 4, which I will read, it's very brief. We say that the first thing with which it is necessary to deal is establishing the existence of the thing that is called soul, end quote. However, shortly afterwards, the presence of two levels within Avicenna's investigation of the soul is certified. And at the same time, the preference for one over the other is attested, at least at this stage of the investigation. And I quote, is your text 5. This expression, namely Nafs, soul, anima, is a name for this thing, not with respect to its substance, but in virtue of a certain relationship it has, namely in virtue of its being principle for these investigations, end quote. That was existence the philosopher is going to investigate is the soul. However, this term does not designate the thing in itself, but rather the thing insofar as it is the principle of activities. It's a kind of operational level. Here, the distinction of references of the terms shy, thing, res, and nafs, soul, anima, is pivotal. The former refers to an entity in its totality having its own essence, being separable from the body and conceivable independently of it. The latter, by contrast, designates only one characteristic of this shy, of this thing, that is its mode of existence in relation to the body. Thus, there is the implicit recognition that there is something behind and besides what the term soul designates, though this is applicable not to every kind of soul. However, its investigation is set, I would say, temporarily aside. At the outset of the psychological investigation, its target is thus limited to the aspect for which the thing is called soul, namely, its being principle of the activities in bodies. So, the aspect according to which the soul is a relational entity. This phenomenal datum is crucial. Direct observation is precisely the basis of the a posteriori proof of the soul's existence, a proof concerning all sublunary souls existing in bodies, according to which whoever sees activities in bodies cannot deny that in them there is a soul. Once the existence of this thing, insofar as it has a certain characteristic, here even referred to as accident, harad, or accidents, is established, and this is the only conclusion that can be drawn from direct observation, Avicenna twice defers the ascertainment of its essence and of the category to which it belongs to another investigation, which will take place in chapter 2 of the first treatise of the Kitab al-Nafs. Although the advancement of knowledge from the level of existence to that of the essence is recommended, it is impossible to infer the substantiality of what is a soul from the very fact that it is a soul. In the very same way, Avicenna says, in which elsewhere the knowledge that something which is in motion as a mover does not immediately imply the knowledge of the essence of that mover. Of course, the reference is to the physics of the Shifa, where this is one of the main tenets of Avicenna, put the demonstration of the existence of the first unmoved mover in metaphysics and not in physics. The investigation of the soul belonging to natural philosophy seems to be then an investigation of it insofar as it has a certain relation to matter and motion, that is, insofar as it governs the body with respect to which it is defined. And this is the text 6 of your handout from which I derived the quote of the paper title, which will recur again at the end of the work and at the end of my paper. So the quotation is drawn from chapter 1-1, and the context is bigger than these four lines. So the idea is basically that we can define the soul, or the soul, the definition of the soul, the standard Aristotelian definition of the soul, and even though I will not enter this discussion here, I don't think this is Avicenna's definition of the soul, but it's just the standard Aristotelian peripatetic definition of the soul, has to include, since the soul is a relational entity, has to include the mention of the body, in the very same way in which the definition of the builder has to include, qua builder, so not qua human being, has to include the mention of the building. So in this passage you see that Avicenna explicitly, places the investigation of the soul in natural philosophy, in natural science, because it has always a relation, considered always in connection with the body, namely with matter and motion, which is the main subject of natural philosophy, what is subjected to motion and rest. So despite the limitations that Avicenna posits to his psychological investigation, the other investigation, to which the ascertainment of the essence of the soul is deferred, seems to take place in psychology at any rate. In addition to the presence in psychology of the ontological counterpart of the investigation of the soul as operational principle, in Nafs 1.1, Avicen also acknowledges the presence of something behind and besides what the term nafs designates. Though not being the case of all sublunary souls, it raises the question as to whether the ascertainment of what the soul in itself is pertains to psychology or to another higher science. In the time I have at my disposal, I will take into account four chapters in which Avicenna seems to ascribe also this investigation to psychology and to conduct it therein, namely the prologue to Nafs, chapter 1.1 and 1.3, and chapter 5.2. So let's start with the prologue. The prologue to the Nafs contains the manifesto of Avicenna's psychological investigation, in which its place and its subject matter are discussed. Perhaps because in the age of Avicenna there was still disagreement about its epistemological status. The prologue can be divided into three parts, and I will focus on the first two parts, of which I have translated, I have translated the prologue in an article listing the bibliography, but in this, in your handout, I have put under text 7 almost all the two parts I'm discussing. So in the first part of the prologue, after providing an overview of the contents of the five previous sections on natural philosophy in the Shifa, and this part is not included in the text 7, Avicenna assigns priority to investigation of the soul over that of issues specifically concerning plants and animals. In the second part, he expounds in detail the nature of such an investigation and accounts for the methodology that he follows in it. The investigation that is about to start is general and unitary. It is general because it deals with the soul qua formal principle of any kind of sublunary living being in general terms. And it is unitary because the inquiry into the soul is approached in a comprehensive rather than piecemeal way. Investigations of the various instances of sublunary soul not being severed from one another. There are two reasons for preferring a general and unitary account of the soul. The first reason is a parte objecti, while the second, I would say, is a parte subjecti. Firstly, severing the subject matter of this inquiry, namely the soul, on the basis of its various sublunary instances, vegetative, animals, and human, would jeopardize the possibility of grasping the science of the soul as a whole, where every part of the soul is related to another. This idea can be traced back to Aristotle's concept in De Anima 2.3 of the several instances of soul as items arranged in an ordered series, where a lower soul can be found potentially in the higher one, in the very same way in which, in the case of rectilinear figures, the triangle can be found potentially in the square, etc. And no soul in a universal exists apart from its instances. So no figure exists beyond a triangle. And numbers, for example, nothing apart from two exists, no number in general. This is, for example, in metaphysics beta. So knowledge of the soul is therefore the knowledge of all its instances. In this connection, dealing separately with each of its instances would break up the unity of the subject matter of the science of the soul and consequently dissolve the entire science, the science itself. The second reason concerns the one who investigates, namely the human being and ultimately us, namely the human being engaged in doing psychology, in particular because of our difficulty in grasping the specific differences of each instance of soul and of its bearer, which fall outside our cognitive faculties due to their extreme specificity. So we have to deal only with what is shared. That being the case, the investigation of the soul has to be an investigation of the common features that all instances of sublunary souls share. The specific features of each of them, though essential per se, have to be left outside because it is extremely difficult for us to grasp them. These two reasons account for the general and unitary character of Avicenna's investigation of the soul, which pertains to one single science and is contained in one single work, Fi Kitab Wahid, or In Uno Libro. However, a remark is in order. Evaluation of the common features shared by all sublunary souls, which represent the topic of this investigation, is made by the one who investigates, that is, by a human being having himself as a touchstone in this evaluation. Consequently, the investigation does deal with what is shared, but from a human perspective, that is, through the mediation of the investigator's direct acquaintance with his own soul, namely the human soul, which is at the same time what investigates by means of the intellectual activity, but also a subject, part of the subject under investigation, because it's an instance of sublunary soul. Therefore, thou showing a general approach, aiming at providing the most comprehensive account of the soul insofar as it is the vital principle of all sublunary living beings, and thus guaranteeing the investigation of the soul a unitary subject matter, Avicenna's science of the soul seems to have also a specific orientation, focusing on the human soul and on what it shares with plants and animals, and not the other way around, due to the investigator's privileged and direct access to it. As we shall see, examples of this specific orientation are the thought experiment of the flying man at the end of Nafs 1-1, which hints at the incorporeal nature of the human soul, and the lengthy discussion of the human rational soul in the fifth treatise, the fifth treatise of the Book of the Soul. The transition from the inquiry into the existence of the soul as a relational entity to that into the essence is marked by the flying man argument. The thought experiment of the flying man, or man in the void, is probably the most famous passage of Avicenna's Nafs. Here the focus, the thought experiment occurs twice, in Nafs 1-1 and 5-7, with different purposes, but I will focus on the first and more complete formulation at the end of the first chapter of the first treatise. The first version of the thought experiment consists, as you will know, of two moves. In the first move, Avicenna invites the reader to imagine himself in the state of a mature human being and as fluttering in the air or in the void in a condition of complete sensory deprivation and lack of memory. In the second move, the reader has to consider whether in the aforementioned state he will affirm the existence of anything. According to Avicenna, he will be prompted to affirm the existence of his essence, although he will not affirm the existence of anything corporeal, neither of his external body, nor of his internal organs, like the heart or the brain, which are generally considered human beings' most basic organs in philosophical and medical tradition. Furthermore, even if he were to imagine any other organ, he would imagine it neither as a part of his essence nor as a condition for its existence. Generally speaking, the outcome of this experiment is the affirmation of the existence of the essence of the human soul as something different from the body, namely immaterial. This thought experiment occurs at the end of the investigation of the traditional definition of the soul in Nafs 1-1, and seems to be intended to connect this investigation with that of the essence of the soul in Nafs 1-3. 1-2, the chapter in between, has just a doxographical character, which is important, but I mean the bridge is between 1-1 and 1-3. We can discuss of the reason for this doxography perhaps later. That the thought experiment marks a change of direction with respect to the investigation that Avicenna has conducted so far is clearly stated in the introduction to the experiment. And this is the text 8 of your endowment, yes. I quote, "We have now known the meaning of the term that applies to the thing called soul, in virtue of a relation belonging to it. We ought then to engage ourselves in grasping the quiddity of this thing, which, through the aforementioned consideration, is said to be soul." End quote. Avicenna aims to move from the traditional definition of the soul to the ascertainment of its quiddity. In virtue of the possession of a certain accident, namely an idafa, a relatio to the body, a certain thing is said to be soul. However, the quiddity of the thing bearing the name awaits this name, awaits to be ascertained. The distinction of references of the terms shy, thing, and nafs, soul, which Avicenna has hinted at the beginning of 1.1, as we have read in text 5, is thus confirmed. However, that the soul of any sublunary living being, so the relation, what is, was the relational soul, the relational aspect of the soul, so that exists, has already been shown in the opening lines of chapter 1.1 by means of direct observation. As we have seen, the fact that bodies perform certain activities show that there is something behind or besides their corporeality which is responsible for these activities. Therefore, establishing again the existence of one of its instances would be at the same time redundant and pointless. But the conclusion of the experiment might cast some light on this aspect, and this is text 9 in the endowed. I quote, "The recipient of the pointing as a way to be alerted to the existence of the soul as something other than the body, indeed other than body," end quote. Therefore, by means of the thought experiment of the flying man, Avicenna seems to aim to establish not that the soul of human beings exists without qualification, but rather that it is in itself something different from all body, namely something incorporeal. The conclusion of the flying man argument can be defined as negative. It allows us to establish what the soul belonging to us is not, namely body. Incorporeality meaning not being body. The positive conclusion, by contrast, which is based on the notion of independence or independent existence, represents a step forward in the ascertainment of what the human soul in itself is, and will be offered in the opening lines of the chapter 3 of the first treatise, and demonstratively displayed only in Nafs 5.2, so at the end of this journey that we are doing together. The outcome of this experiment is thus restricted to the human rational soul, the only instance of sublunary soul in which there is a shy, a thing, behind and besides what Nafs designates, and which is consequently capable of existing in a condition of isolation from the body, as will emerge in the course of the treatise. What is more, this restriction echoes the prologue to the Nafs, where Avicenna states that it is difficult to grasp the specific differences of each instance of soul, and therefore we should limit ourselves to what is common to all sublunary souls. In the case of the human soul, however, this difficulty is overcome because we are our soul. In the experiment, the human being's that, namely essence, is identified with the human being's soul, and hence perfectly able to account for its peculiar nature due to its privileged and direct access to it. The knower, namely his core being taken in isolation, as happens in the thought experiment, and the object of knowledge are one and the same thing. The role that the flying man plays within the context of Nafs 1.1 is therefore to mark a transition from the inquiry into the existence of the soul as an operational principle to the essence inquiry. However, at the level of the flying man, the essence inquiry is not the inquiry into the quiddity of the soul of the body, that is the counterpart of the investigation of the sublunary soul qua operational principle, which is conducted in Nafs 1.1, to which Nafs 1.3 will be devoted. Rather, this first step is a first step of the essence inquiry, providing a means by which those who are perspicacious enough can immediately acknowledge the incorporeality of their soul, namely what their soul, their human soul in itself, is. Avicenna seems to leave open the possibility that besides the exclusive, in the sense that restricted, flying man argument, restricted with respect to the recipient of the argument, another argument can be provided bearing the same conclusion but understandable by those who are not sufficiently perspicacious. We can get some information about this from a passage from the Mubahatat, so Avicenna's discussions, in which he seems to suggest that behind or besides the, I like behind, design, so I don't know if you noticed, behind the flying man argument, you will have an argument built according to genus and species, so a demonstration in the proper sense, for those who are not perspicacious enough to the tambi, so this pointing argument. So that the transition to the essence inquiry is accomplished, namely transition from the existence to the essence inquiry is accomplished, is marked by Nafs 1.3, which is entitled Chapter Concerning the Fact that the Soul Falls Under the Category of Substance. So, just to summarize briefly what we get. We have 1.1 on the existence of the soul of bodies. Then we have the flying man switching to the essence, not the essence of the soul of that we found, lunar soul, but the human soul in itself. Then in 1.3 we found an investigation of the essence of the soul of sublunary living beings, so the counterpart of the existence investigation. The introductory line of this chapter, which I quoted in text 10, are crucial to understand the kind of investigation that Avicenna is here embarking on. I quote, "We ourselves say," basically Avicenna is giving here the summary I just gave you now, "we ourselves say, you know from what preceded that the soul is not body. One thing. If it is established for you that it rightly happens for some soul the isolation from the body because of its self-subsistence, you will not doubt that it is a substance. Second. And third, this, however, is established for you only in the case of something that is said to be soul. In the case of other things, such as the vegetative and the animal soul, this has not been established for you yet." End quote. Here, three elements are noteworthy, appointed not with the letters. So, by referring to what preceded, Avicenna resumes the general conclusion emerging from the investigation conducted in Nafs 1.1, namely that the soul is other than body. At the beginning of Nafs 1.1, he says, there are, bodies, natural bodies, are composed of two parts, one part according to which they are, in virtue of which they are in potentiality, the body, and something else according to which they are in virtue of which they are in actuality, which is, he says, form, like a perfection, which is the soul. So different from the body. And the other thing is the specific conclusion of the flying man experiment that is summarizing it. However, here Avicenna goes a bit further than the proper conclusion of the flying man. There it has been negatively concluded that the human soul is incorporeal. Here, positively, I would say, that it is something independent of the body, and for this very reason, substance. Therefore, the demonstration of the substantiality of the human soul in itself, that is in the condition of complete isolation from the body, a condition that it is the only kind of sublunary soul to enjoy, is considered unnecessary. Avicenna can therefore focus on the third aspect, the proper demonstration of the quiddity of the soul of plants and animals. In a way, and we can discuss about it, human beings included, that while existing in the sublunary world is always connected with matter and motion, a connection that might raise some doubts about its substantiality, which thus needs to be demonstrated. However, in spite of its bodily existence, the soul of plants and animals is a substance, not an accident, because it is in the body, not like an accident in a subject, but like a form in a receptacle. And this is text 11. Therefore, the existence of the soul, Avicenna says, in the body is not like the existence of the accident in the subject. Then the soul is a substance because it is a form not in a subject. End quote. In order to account for the substantiality of the vegetative and the animal souls, Avicenna revives his standard criterion of substantiality derived from Aristotle's categories, together with Aristotelian hylomorphism. What is not in a subject at all is said to be a substance, and since the form is not in matter, as in a hypokeimenon, as in a subject, and since the form, the form is or can be a substance. Therefore, the sublunary soul, that in Nafs 1.1 has been investigated on the operational level, in Nafs 1.3 is proved to be a substance insofar as it is a form. The investigation conducted in Nafs 1.1 and 1.3 respectively are thus complementary. The latter ascertains the quiddity of the thing of which the former ascertains the existence on the basis of its relation to the body. So we have 1.1 with the exclusion of the flying man, and 1.3 as complementary. Investigation of the soul of, I would put in italics, soul of plants and animals, I mean, soul of sublunary living beings. And we are left with the flying man experiment concerning the human soul in itself. However, as you can see, there is no balance within these two investigations, so this cannot be the end of the whole story. For, as I said, we are left with the conclusion of the flying man about the human soul considered in itself and its refinement at the beginning of Nafs 1.3, where Avicenna goes from incorporeality to independence in existence, which are not universal, is not a universal conclusion available to everyone, because the flying man is addressed to the perspicacious reader, and I think, I suspect, that the not better specified soul whose substantiality is immediately acknowledged in virtue of the kind of existence it enjoys at the beginning of Nafs 1.3, in all likelihood, and in the very same vein of the flying man experiment, refers not to the human soul in general, but to the particular soul belonging to a particular man. Thus, only the man reflecting on himself will not doubt that it, and not whatever human soul, is a self-subsistent substance, since the knowledge he attains by means of this reflection is not based on demonstration, and consequently is not universal. At the beginning of 1.3, just to remind you, what is the text here? He says, if it is, point B, if it is established for you that it rightly happens for some soul, the isolation, etc. So, which is the referent of this some soul? I think is the same soul to which Avicenna refers at the end of 1.1 with the flying man experiment. Is the soul of the one engaging in the experiment, which arrives at a kind of individual, non-demonstrative, subjective knowledge. So, as I just said, this is an individual, intuitive, non-demonstrative conclusion that we get from the flying man. So by speaking of its isolated self-subsistence, Avicenna does not aim to introduce an alternative criterion of substantiality with the same status of his standard one, but he simply hints at a way to get immediate subjective non-demonstrative access to the substantiality of a particular human soul, the soul of a human being reflecting on himself. This human soul is a substance because it is self-subsistent, is a self-subsistent entity, and therefore it makes no sense to wonder whether it is in a subject or not, because what enjoys a condition of independent existence is a fortiori not in a subject at all. However, in spite of its immediate acknowledgement, the substantiality of the human soul considered in itself and on a universal level seems to await a proper demonstration. In my reconstruction, this demonstration is provided in Nafs 5.2, which is entitled, tellingly, Chapter on Establishing that the Rational Soul Does Not Subsist as Imprinted in a Corporeal Matter. Here Avicenna aims to demonstrate that the human soul is an incorporeal substance capable of self-subsistence. So, it is noteworthy that here, with respect to the human rational soul in itself, we are in the presence of the very same transition from the level of existence to that of essence that in Nafs 1-1 is marked by the Flame Man experiment. There, however, Avicenna passes from the demonstration of the existence of sublunary soul in general to the allusion to the essence of one of them, namely the human soul considered in itself, the flying man, and lastly to the demonstration of the essence of all sublunary souls, Nafs 1-3. Here, by contrast, it provides a proper demonstration of what has just been hinted at the beginning of the treatise with the flying man. In this manner, Avicenna brings to a proper completion also the second investigation conducted in his psychology, that of the human rational soul in itself, whereas, as I said, and repeat myself, in Nafs 1-1-3, he has already accomplished the investigation of the existence and the essence of the sublunary soul of plants and animals, insofar as they are a relational entity. The title of both Nafs 1-1 and 5-2 have in common the word if but, establishing the existence, affirmare esse or essentia. In spite of their different purpose, the if but of 1-1 and 5-2 share the same status and the same method. They designate an a posteriori proof starting from the observation of some activities and their object for which the soul is responsible. So are general psychic faculties in the case of Nafs 1-1 and the specific activity of the human rational soul, namely intellection, in 5-2. The fact that 5-2 contains something different from the investigation general accomplished in the first treatise of Nafs and reconnects with what is alluded to in the flying man experiment, thou providing something more, especially with respect to the logical status of the argument, emerges again from its opening lines. And this is the text 12, which I think, no, it's not the last one. So I quote, "One thing about which there is no doubt is that in the human being there is a thing and a certain substance that obtains the intelligibles by receiving them. We say that the substance that is the receptacle of the intelligibles is in no way a body, nor is subsisting in a body, either as a faculty in it or as a form belonging to it." End quote. The quiditative focus of the investigation Avicenna is embarking on is immediately revealed. It concerns a thing considered in its totality and having its essence. We are already familiar with the word, the use of shy or rest with this meaning, and a substance whose nature has to be demonstrated in this chapter. And here, thing and substance must be considered as an entities. This thing is the intellecting substance, which Avicenna has hinted at in the flying man experiment and cursorily at the beginning of Nafs 1-3. This intellecting substance, that is the receptacle of intelligibles in human beings, basically the human rational soul, is said to be by no means a body. That the human soul is not body chimes with the general conclusion of Nafs 1-1 and echoes the incorporeality of the human soul which emerged from the flying man experiment. However, here the demonstrandum is the fact that the human rational soul in itself is an immaterial substance, I would say a stronger argument. So not just what is not, but it is an immaterial substance. By contrast, that the soul of plants and animals existing in body is incorporeal and is a substance has been already demonstrated because the soul, we have said, the soul of plants and animals is a form, and qua form is incorporeal. And is a substance because it is not in a receptacle, not in a subject, but in a receptacle. That the scenario and the purpose of this investigation in 5-2 are different from those of the first treatise of Nafs is confirmed by Avicenna himself. What will be demonstrated is that this substance, which is not body, does not subsist in a body, neither as a faculty nor as a form. The fact that Avicenna rules out the possibility that the human rational soul is a form in a body, by means of which the substantiality of the soul of plants and animals has been accounted for, testifies the change of focus of the inquiry and the transition from the investigation of the soul of to that of the soul in itself. Together with the possibility that the human rational soul is a form, Avicenna also excludes that it is a faculty in a body. This aspect needs to be spelled out because the exclusion that the human rational soul is a faculty represents another stronger confirmation of the aforementioned change of focus. For here, the rational soul is not investigated insofar as it is a faculty belonging to the soul of a human being, but rather insofar as it is the essence of that soul, what a certain soul is in itself, what remains when its relation to the body is severed, and it is in a condition of complete isolation from the body. This also chimes with Avicenna's rejection in Nafs 1.1 not only of Sura, form as a way to refer to the soul, but also of Quwa, virtus, in the sense of power or faculty. Now, we have finished our journey. And after providing a survey of the enterprise accomplished by Avicenna in his Nafs, we can attempt to answering the opening question, that is, as to whether psychology conforms to the model of demonstrative science outlined retrospectively in metaphysics or not. So my answer would be this: if, as part of natural philosophy de facto, psychology had limited itself to investigate the soul in connection with matter and motion, namely as the formal principle of the body immanent to it, which accounts for its functional organization and the activities observable therein, and it had just hinted at its ontological status, namely its being substance insofar as it is a form, Avicenna's model of science would have perfectly worked also in the case of psychology. For in metaphysics, in particular in chapter 2.1, Avicenna provides a classification of the different kinds of substance that are going to be dealt with in metaphysics, and form is one of them. Therefore, the use of this notion in natural philosophy turns out to be metaphysically founded, and the anticipation of its treatment can be justified for, let's say, propedeutic reasons, like that of categories in the logic. So just to intimate of the to the essence of this entity, of which in psychology we are just investigating the activities. However, at least a part of psychology inquires into the existence and the quiddity of what is more similar to the celestial substances of metaphysics than to the general and corruptible bodies of natural philosophy, namely the human rational soul. And this is what Avicenna says in his psychology and his metaphysics, the really similarity between celestial and human souls. What is more, no metaphysical foundation of such an inquiry is provided. Conversely, metaphysics seems to assume the conclusion of this investigation or to merely supplement it without providing further validation. Examples of this are the metaphysical treatment of the celestial souls and of eschatology. We can discuss later on also on this aspect if you want. However, because I know that I'm running out of time, but I'm finishing. However, in metaphysics, Avicenna seems not to be bothered by this disciplinary trespassing, which seems to be an exception to his his scientific model. Rather, at least in two occasions, he seems to authorize it explicitly. In psychology, by contrast, Avicenna seems to be worried by the possibility that psychology might transcend the boundaries of natural philosophy and protrude into metaphysics. For this reason, the investigation of the immateriality of the soul in 5.2 and of its individual immortality in 5.4 is somehow counterbalanced by reaffirming the necessity of the human soul's relationship with the body and reiterating the main purpose of the investigation conducted in Nafs. Almost at the end of Nafs, in 5.5, and this is the last text, I will not read it because it's too long, Avicenna secures the investigation of the soul conducted so far as properly pertaining to natural philosophy By distinguishing what is conceived as a real possibility, the human soul's independent existence, from its fulfillment, and reiterates the focus of Nafs in the very same manner he did at the beginning of the work, namely Nafs 1.1. He said again that natural philosophy, in which psychology is placed, I'm just paraphrasing text 13, is an investigation, it should pertain to natural philosophy because it is an investigation of the soul qua connected, related to matter and motion. To conclude, really, we are in the presence of a shadowy area of Avicenna's psychology and in general of his epistemology, which seems to suffer from a structural tension. The psychological treatment of the existence and the quiddity of the human soul seems to enjoy the same exceptional status of the metaphysical treatment of God, with which that of the soul shares in some similarities. In both sciences, Avicenna deals with the existence and the quiddity of a part of their subject by contravening the rule that he posited in Hilayat, in metaphysics, even though in the case of God, existence and essence overlap or coincide. From this perspective, one might wonder whether, according to Avicenna, the fact that a science ascertains the existence and the quiddity, not of its subject in its entirety, but just of a part of it, is plausible and acceptable. However, if in the case of the treatment of God in metaphysics is not particularly surprising, since there is no other science above metaphysics to which the ascertainment of the necessary existence could have pertained, the case of the treatment of the existence and the quiddity of the human soul in psychology is different, since it is a subordinate special science, and one would have expected to find in metaphysics something more fundamental concerning all soul than what is there in psychology. Thank you very much.